Hello everyone, welcome to the second part of my YouTube series about making a safe game in Godot. In the first part we've talked about how to store data in a file and load the data from the file into your game. And in this part we will specifically talk about making a proper UI for your save and load menu. So in order to do that, let's first take a look at the game. This is the menu that I'm talking about for saving, and also a very similar menu for loading a game. I decided to have those two menus very similar because I find it's sort of standard to do that, at least in most games I've played. And obviously they have very similar information that need to be displayed on the screen. So it is kind of useful to have a sort of similar design for them so that you can reuse a lot of code. And that is also why in my script I've decided to have just one script for both menus. So this is the script that we will be using alongside with the save slot script and the game event manager script, which we'll talk about later on. Now in terms of scenes, we have two scenes that we need to take a look at. One is the load save menu scene, and the other one is the save slot scene. So those look like this. Let's start off with the save slot scene. The save slot scene is, as the name implies, a scene for just one slot. For one save slot, which represents one save file in the menu. In my case, this consists of a thumbnail, in which you can right now see just a question mark, but if you have a valid save file, you get a screenshot of the game in there, and the thumbnail border, which is the white border around here, and the date clock, which is this string here, that will consist later on of the date and the time at which the save file was last written to. And obviously also the file name as a string, or as a label in this case, consisting of a string. So with that, we can take a look at the save slot script, which we can access like so. And this script isn't needed necessarily. As you can see, it just contains a few utility functions to make things easier in our other scripts. So the most important is the set slot function, which updates our thumbnail graphic, our file name string, and our date clock string according to our input parameters. After that, we have this partial modulate function, which is used for the selection later on to make a save slot reselected visually. You might remember that it turns yellow certain parts of the save slot, which is in this case the border, the file name, and the date clock. And we need this because if we were to say that the whole save slot set modulate gets turned yellow, then also the thumbnail itself would turn yellow. So the graphic would turn yellow. And that is obviously not what we want. So this is why we have this partial modulate function in here to just set those elements of a save slot to turn yellow that we want to actually have turn yellow, or whatever color we want to have later on. In my case, it's yellow. Then we also have a get file name function, which is just here for me to say that, okay, I want the actual text that is in this file name label. I want that to have returned. Again, this is all just utility stuff. A different thing, however, is when we take a look at the load save menu, that is actually quite a bit of stuff. So let's start off with the elements that we actually have in our UI. We have a background that is just this rectangle here. We have a menu title, and the menu title will change depending on whether we are in a load menu or in a save menu. We have those arrow up and down keys in case we have more than three save slots that we could load from or save to, so that we can scroll up and down in our menu. And then we have three save slots in here. Now, some people will say that it is... Let me say it differently. So some people will say you can instantiate the different elements that you want in your UI dynamically when you call the UI, so that you have at runtime, for example, 10 save slots because you have 10 different files in your directory. And that is a valid approach that you can do. I, however, am of the opinion that stuff like that complicates a lot of things. So I tend to use a different approach, which is I have the maximum amount of elements that I can display on my screen at one time and put them in here statically, as you can see as nodes of my load save menu. And all I'm doing for iterating through the different files via scrolling or whatever is that I change the according attributes of those save slots. So I might be at the very beginning, my first save slot, it would display the name of the first file and the date and the thumbnail. But if I scroll down, while this save slot, the elements in there don't change, as in they won't get deleted or something, they will get changed in what they display. So they will display a different text and a different thumbnail for a different file at that point. So while this is called save slot zero, it doesn't mean that it is the first save also, always. It can be the first save that you get returned from your OS. It can also be like the third last save that your OS returns. It depends. And this is an approach I tend to do and that I find very reasonable and I can work very well with. You might be different on that. That's totally up to you how you want to solve it. But this is the way I do it. Okay, so the last element that we have here is this line edit, which is a normal Godot control node, like so. And all that it does is allow you to have this input line where you can insert text in via keyboard. And it is used for renaming files and setting the name of a new file that you want to have. It is obviously only needed in the save menu. But yeah, as this menu is used for both set and load menus, it is obviously needs to be in here. And we only need one of those line edits, because we can just change the position around of the line edit depending on which of those three save slots we want to change the file name of. Okay, so that is how the load save menu looks. Now we get to the difficult part, which is explaining the script. Now, if you have watched past tutorials of mine, you might already be familiar with some of the stuff I'm doing here, but I try to explain everything in detail so that you don't need to rely on older tutorials. Okay, so let's start off with this function ready in here, because it just has this one method, this one function, which is retranslate. And retranslate is needed in case you have multiple, in case you want to support multiple languages in your game. Meaning it is a specialized function that I made that is just there for, in this case, setting the proper title for the menu in the according language. So if we are in a load menu, which we can figure out by using this condition for this Boolean here, we use the identifier load menu title and use this tr command to look up in our language pack what kind of string this should actually be for the current language that we are using. If you want to know more about how language packs and all that stuff works, I have a specialized tutorial for that, that you can look at. But if you are just interested in this save game script for your game, you don't necessarily need this step here. You need this line in the sense that you need to assign the proper title for your menu. But you don't need this tr load menu stuff. You could also just write load menu and save menu, and those parts are commented out. That is also completely valid. Okay. So that was the ready function. And let's take a look at what's up next. Well, I guess we should go with process, I would assume. So process is, as you might know if you're already familiar with Godot, is a function that gets called repeatedly for the according object that the script is attached to. And in my case, I decided to have sort of fade in, fade out effect for the menu, in the sense that it's fading in, but also moving into the screen and moving out of the screen, and while it's moving out of the screen, it also is fading out. So that is basically what we are trying to implement in here. We have a lerp value, which we also have up here, lerp value of 1, And to that load value, we add the transition speed, which is a constant that we have defined up here, times the delta. The delta is obviously the argument delta up here, and is the time that has passed since the last time this process was called. And in case lerp value is bigger than 1, lerp value just equals 1. We need to do that, because later on, when we want to use the lerp value, we shouldn't work with values above 1. And I will explain that in just a bit. So the alpha value is in this case equal to the lerp value as a default. However, we need to figure out whether we are transitioning in to the UI or transitioning out of the UI, because depending on that, we will have to move the UI off the screen or into the screen, and we have to fade in or fade out the UI. So depending on that, whether we are fading in or fading out, or transitioning in or transitioning out, alpha value is either equal to lerp value or 1 minus lerp value. Okay, so then we get to this lerp function in here. As you can see, in both cases we are quite similar. The only real difference in here is that our initial start value in transition in is the transition out offset, which is also a constant up here. And that defines basically the Y position of our UI when it is fully transitioned out. That is our start value, and our goal value or end value is the transition in offset, which is this. And depending on what value lerp value has, again, it needs to have a value between 0 and 1 in order for this to work properly. We are either closer to the transition out offset or closer to the transition in offset. And we get any value in between those two values that is percentage-wise at the position of lerp value. So if the lerp value is 1, we get the same value as in the transition in offset. If lerp value is 0, we get the transition out offset. And if it's 0.5, we get the value right in the middle of those two values. Yeah. And in case we are transitioning out, then we have to use the exact opposite positioning of those values in the function. Because now we are starting out from the transition in offset, because we are transitioning out, so the UI is already visible on the screen. That is our start value, and we want to get the UI completely out of the screen. So our goal is to transition, to get to the transition out offset with the lerp value. And we are always lerping from 0 to 1. So that is why for the alpha value, we need to use the reverse value in a way if we are transitioning out, so that we are not fading in, but fading out in that way. And that's what we are doing with setModulate in here. So setModulate just sets the color value of the UI to the default value with the according alpha value that we get from the lerp value, or that we get with calculation of the alpha value by using the lerp value. After that, we set our global position of the UI with our transition offset that we have calculated here and our offset x, which is a constant in my case, which is that one. Now, obviously, if you are making your own game, you could also, instead of transitioning in via the y-axis, you could also transition in via the x-axis, or exclusively via the x-axis, so that it would move in from left to right, or from right to left, instead of from bottom to top. And then you would have to change the according variables here. Then offset y would be your constant, and the transition offset would be in the x value of this vector here. Okay, so after that, we get to the more specialized part of the script, which is, depending on whether we are editing a file name, we either call the process editing or the process selection. And that is important, because obviously when we want to change a file name, we don't want to be able to still select another file name in the UI. That would just be really weird and confusing for the user. So we lock that in, that other files, other save slots can't be selected anymore, once we are in this is editing state, then we can only use exclusively the process editing function, which we get to now. So the process editing also needs the delta and the alpha value, or it is at least useful in a way to have that in case we want to add further changes via the process editing, which is, for example, in this case, the line edit. Once we are in process editing, we want to have our line edit to be displayed. But we want it to be displayed in the same way that the rest of your UI is displayed. So in case we are editing our file name, and we decide to fade out of the UI for some reason, then we don't want the line edit node to be fully visible all the time. We want it to also fade out the same way if we are fading in. So that is why we pass the alpha value in the line edit set modulate function, and we also call the grab focus function, which is used so that the keyboard input is actually applied to the line edit. We are setting the focus to the line edit so that all the input that we are doing with the keyboard goes into the line edit and isn't used exclusively for other stuff. Okay, after that we have this max iterations variable, which is equal to the number of slots that we have in our load save menu. And those max iterations, we need to figure out whether they are bigger than the maximum amount of save entries that we actually have. Because if that is the case, then the save entry size, then the max iteration size should be equal to the save entry size. And that is a condition that is necessary in case that we have only two or maybe one file. Because all the script is dependent on the fact that we have three save slots and we update those three save slots. But in case that we have only two saves, then the third save slot shouldn't be visible, shouldn't be selectable, right? Because there's no actual save data in there. So that is important in any case, even when we are in the process editing function, as you will see in just a minute. After that, we ask for whether the UI cancel button was pressed, which is the default description for the escape key in Godot. So if that's the case, then is editing is set to false, we basically cancel our editing process by setting is editing to false and making line edit invisible and also deleting the text of line edit, just in case that some script might want to do use it later on. And that way we make sure, okay, there is no stuff in there for some other part of the script to use. So with that, we get to the for loop of the save slot index, in which we are basically iterating over every save slot. We get the current save slot that we want to process by calling getNode, save slot, and we are calling index. So that is why we have this naming convention with 0, 1, and 2. And then we go and figure out whether that is the currently selected save slot. And if that's the case, we do this partial modulate in order to color the save slots or part of the save slot. And most importantly, we set the line edit position to the position of the current save slot with a bit of an offset in order for it to look nice. Yeah. So that's it so far for process editing. Now there's also this process selection here that we will talk about now. As you can see, this is a long function, but it should be pretty obvious once you realize the concept. Because we are in the process selection process, we don't actually need to display the line edit at this point. So that is why we set the line edit to be invisible via setModulate. After that, we are dealing with key input in order to navigate through the different save slots. And in order to do that, we have these two conditions here. The first one is asking whether we are fully transitioned in. So transition in is set to true and the lerp value is set to 1. That means we are fully transitioned in, everything is visible, and from that point on we can go ahead and process all the input that the player wants to make. We also have this condition in here, the key wait time greater or equals key repeat wait time, and that is used in order to make sure that when the player has pressed down the key, that there is some sort of wait time before the proper key processing step is performed each time. If we didn't have that, that would mean that if a key is pressed down, the navigation through the menu would be so fast that it wouldn't actually be easy to navigate through the menu, because you can't really hit the proper entry that you want to select. Now there is a different way to solve the same problem, which is instead of checking whether the key is pressed down, you are asking for whether the key was pressed down for the first frame or rather whether the key was pressed down and released before you process the next key down. And that is possible, obviously, but I don't find that to be good UI design, because some people have problems pressing keys repeatedly because their hand hurts or something. And for them, it is really good if they can just press a key once and leave the hand basically on the key and don't have to move the hand at all anymore for at least a few seconds. And also for me personally, I find it, for the lack of a better term, more relaxing to just press the key down and wait until the proper entry was selected, instead of being like, okay, I have to press this key repeatedly as fast as possible to get to the entry that I want to select. So yeah, that is why I'm using this approach. If you want to take another one, that's up to you. So yeah, that is why we have this condition in here, and all it does basically, the key wait time gets increased with the delta that we pass to the process selection. So the time that has passed since the last time this was called. And if enough time has passed, defined by the key repeat wait time constant, which is this value here, then we can go ahead and process the input. So at that point, what we are doing is asking for the different keys that we have. In my case, because my menu is scrolling up and down, I ask for the up arrow key and the down arrow key and also the return key in order to perform an action on a save slot. So what we have here is, if a save entry size is greater than 0, so we have save entries to iterate through, then the selected save slot index, when we ask whether the selected save slot index is greater than 0, and if that's the case, we reduce the selected save slot index by 1, meaning if we are, for example, at save slot 1 with our selection, and we have at that point obviously more save entries than 0, then we can reduce our selected save slot, and that would put us to save slot 0 at this point. So we have selected the entry above the one that we currently have, which is what we want to do with the up arrow key. Yeah. So if we haven't selected something above 0, so at that point we are at save slot 0, then we have to take a different approach. For one, we have to figure out whether the save slot 0 really is the very first save slot that we actually have. Because again, as I iterated on earlier, even though there are only 3 save slots displayed at any point in time, we can have more than that, obviously. And when we scroll through the save slot by overwriting the visualized values of the save slots that we have in our menu. So page index is basically our variable to tell whether we really are at the very first save slot, because we have different pages basically for every three save slots. And that isn't entirely true, which I get to in a minute, or maybe a little bit later, but for now, think of it like that. So we ask whether the page index is bigger than zero, then we reduce the page index by one. So instead of the actual selected save slot, we reduce the page index by one. So we get to the three save slots that are a page before that. And again, in just a minute, I will explain the important detail in there, but just to make everything a little bit easier to understand. If that's not the case, so if the save, if the page index is actually zero, then we want to get to the last save slot, to the last save file in that we have available. So our page index at that point is save entry size minus 3. And if the page index size at this point is smaller than 0, then we know that we don't have enough entries for the page index, because we might only have 2 save slots. And if that's the case, we need to do a little bit of a correction. Because when we are at the page index 0, so at the very first page, but our selected save slot index is the number of save entries that we have minus 1. So if we have 2 saves, then we are at page index 0, because we can display them all on this one page. And our selected save slot index, when we go from save slot 0 in here to the last one, would be with the up arrow key, then we would get to the want to get to this one, because this third one doesn't exist, because we only have 2. So yeah, that's what we are basically doing here via this correction, because save entries is 2. And we subtract 1 from that, we would get to save slot 1. Yeah. Okay. And in case page index isn't smaller than 0, then we know that we can actually display our last entry on that third position. And in order to do that, all we have to do is set the selected save slot index to 2, because 2 is our third save slot here. Okay, so that's how the up arrow key works. And now we get to the down arrow key. And I think at that point in time, I should probably tell you about this important detail that I have avoided for so long, because it is not the case that the file entries are exclusive to one page. So let's say we have 4 entries. So we would have a save slot down here also. An imaginative one. Then this would all be page 1, but the fourth entry wouldn't be alone on the second page. So if this was page 0 and this was page 1, then the fourth entry wouldn't be the only one on page 1. Instead, this one, so save slot 1, save slot 2, and save slot, and the fourth save slot, which we would name save slot 3 at that point, because we have started at 0, those 3 would be in page 2. Why did I do that? Well, it does complicate some things, I admit that, but it allows, in terms of the navigation through all this, it allows me to let the player scroll through this whole menu one slot at a time. And this makes the whole scrolling process less confusing. Because if a player is only ever shown one additional slot once the page changes and the topmost slot gets removed, because we only display three slots at a time every time, then the player realizes subconsciously that he's scrolling down, because one by one the slots vanishes and new ones appear. It is a way to find it is a way to subconsciously figure out the way you are taking for down scrolling. Imagine the other scenario. If I were just swapping out all three slots completely, so you have three new files displayed whenever you change the page, it would be really difficult for you to figure out whether you are scrolling down or scrolling up, because you don't know what is the next file if you were scrolling down. You just get to see those three new files, and they could also be the very same files that you have when you scroll up, if you only have like six slots or something, like six entries. And that would really confuse people. So that is why these pages are made in the manner that each subsequent page only has the topmost slot basically removed, but for that another slot is insert, or not the slots but the files get removed, and another one is inserted in there, just one, not three new ones. Okay, so I hope that was understandable. And with that, we can go ahead and figure out how the scrolling down process works. Because so far we have looked at scrolling up. And for scrolling down, the save entries that we have, again, we need to figure out how many save entries we have. So if you have more than zero, then it is actually reasonable to do all this stuff, right? Because at that point we can scroll down actually. So if that's the case, then we try to figure out whether the selected slot index is smaller than the number of slots minus one, and is also smaller than the save entry size minus one. So what does that mean? It means that both the save slot index is not pointing at this slot, but only at this one or this one. And it is also the case that it is not the last save file that we are selecting. And these two things are important to differentiate here, because only when both cases are true, then we can say, okay, just increase the selected slot index. Because if both are true, then that means that we don't need to change a page or anything like that. We can just go down and increase the selected index. If that's not the case, then we actually have to figure out if we are at the last page by asking whether the page index is smaller than the safe entry size minus 3. And if that's the case, then we are not at the last page, so we can increase the page instead of a selected slot index. And if that's the case though, then we want to wrap around. So we want to get to the very first save file again. So we have to set our page index to 0 and our selected slot index to also 0. And yeah, that is how the scrolling down process works at this point. Now, for UI accept, we call the do load save action with both the old file name, so the file name that we get from the node of our current selection, calling get file name on that, so that we can get whatever is in file name at this point in time. And we are calling this with both the old and the new file name because we don't have done any overwriting at this point. So maybe I should go to the do load save action for now in order to explain that properly, which is down here. So the do load save action calls or needs the game event manager in my case. And the game event manager is used to call load game state and save game state, which I've talked about in the previous video of the same series. It is dependent on whether the load menu, we are accessing the load menu or the save menu in this case. And it's also dependent on whether we are editing or not editing, whether we are editing or not editing. That's how I should mark that. Because if we are not editing, so we were selecting previously, then we now are editing. And then we get this whole process edit functionality that we have talked about before. However, if we are editing, then we set it is editing to false, because obviously we don't need to edit anymore. And we call game event manager with old file name and new file name. Because at that point, we want to override the old file name with the new one. However, as I've talked about earlier, we are passing in here old filename and old filename. Why are we doing that? Because if we are in the process selection function, when we aren't editing, so we know that at that point those values should be the same because the filename wasn't changed because editing was not called. Right? So that is why we are passing the both times those two values in here. Because we might use the UI except for our load menu, for example. And our load menu would call the loading via the process selection function. Because there is no editing state when you are loading something. You don't need to overwrite your file name when you are loading from that file. So that is why we have to do that here with old filename and new filename in order to avoid confusion on part of the other scripts. Okay, so once we've done all that with the input processing, we can go ahead and actually display all our proper data that we want to have. So first thing is we ask whether the page index is greater than 0. Because if that's the case, then the error up key should be displayed. Because we are obviously not at the very first files that we can display, but rather we have scrolled down a little bit and might want to scroll back up again. So there should be an icon displayed that tells us, hey, you can actually scroll up. And this, that is what we have here. Similarly, we do the same thing for the page index with the arrow down key, only that we are now asking whether the page index is smaller than the safe entry size -3. Because at that point we know, okay, we can still scroll down, there are still pages left that we can scroll to, and then we can say, okay, the arrow down is actually displayed, and if that's not the case, then we hide it. Okay. After that, we have again our max iterations equals number slot in this case. And if max iteration is bigger than the safe entry size, then max iteration equals the safe entries. So we are only iterating through the number of safe slots that we can actually iterate through. If we have more than three safe entries, we can iterate through all three safe slots and update all of them. If we only have two entries, then we only have two valid safe slots, even though we are by default displaying three, so we iterate only through those two. Okay, and yeah, the iteration, we are doing that down here. If the safe slot index is bigger than the safe entry size -1, then we go ahead and set the slot of getNode to have not a file, not a thumbnail, and not a date time. So why are we doing that? Basically, if we have less safe entries than number of slots available, we need to make it so that the safe slot that are extra won't display any sort of data. So that is why we set it to basically not displaying anything at this point. After that, we go ahead and try to figure out what the actual safe entry index is of the safe slot that we are currently working with. And in order to do that, we just use the safe slot index and add the page index to that. So the actual entry we get by accessing the safe entries with the according safe entry index. And our current safe slot is again, the getNode safe slot with the according safe slot index. So with those two elements here, we can set for the current safe slot the data properly by calling current safe slot set slot with the file name inside the entry with thumbnail image and the modification time string. After that, we just need to figure out whether we are currently at the selected safe slot index, because at that point we also want to color our current safe slot in a bit of a yellow, partially again. And if that's not the case, then we want to revert to the default look of it all. So that was the process function for process selection. Okay. As you can see, this is a lot of stuff, but we are getting through it bit by bit. So we also have covered everything that is in process at this point. So that still leaves us with some more functions that we need to talk about. And in order to do that, let me just figure out what would be the most proper order for that. Yeah, I think we should talk about transition in out first. Transition in out is a function that we use in order to set from outside the script whether we are transitioning in or out of our of the UI basically. And yeah, if transition in is not the same as transition in as our variable that we have in the script in order to identify whether we are transitioning in or out, then we know that we are switching the state of the UI from transitioning into out or vice versa. And at that point, we need to reset our verb value to zero, and transition in obviously gets a new value of trans in. Yeah. So that is that. Yeah. So the next thing would probably be to talk about how it is actually possible to get a new file name in our do load save action. Because so far we have only used do load save action with old file and old file. But as you can see already here, there is this new text parameter in here on this function on line edit text entered new text. And that is kind of interesting because we can attach to our line edit basically a signal or event handling in Godot. And in order to do that, let me just try to figure out how that worked again. Here, right. In basically, not in the inspector image, but in Node, we have this signals stuff here. And with that, we can connect or disconnect certain events with other UI elements. So we can say that our load save menu can get the event that text was input into the line edit from the line edit giving out a signal to the UI. And that is what we are doing in here with the online edit text entered. So we can go ahead and say that we have these different well, the line edit has these two outgoing signals basically, and what we can do is by calling connect here that text entered should also be handled by a different element. In our case, load save menu. So we would go here and click connect. And in here, we can also change the name of the method if we wanted to, but actually we don't need to do that necessarily. I already did that, obviously, but this is how you can do it yourself. And then we have this nice function in here that we also get in our script. So this will get called whenever we are writing stuff in our line edit and pressing enter to complete the input process. At that point, this function is called. And we need to get the old file name, which is still in our save slot file name, because we haven't overwritten that yet, obviously. We get that file name, and we get the new file name based on this new text. New text in here is basically what was put inside the line edit, and that is also what our new file name is. Now, as you can see here, new text edit could also be empty. And we don't want to allow empty names for our file names. We could do that if we wanted to, but I find it not very pleasing if you have an entry that doesn't have a name attached to it. So I decided that this is not what I want. So if nothing was input in the line edit, then new text just equals the old file name. And at that point, do load save action would again be called with old file name and old file name, and nothing would change in the sense of the file names. However, if something was input in new text, then we call do load save action with old file name and the new text that we want to have as a new file name at this point. We also can safely say that is editing is now set to false because we have inputted our text, and therefore we can go back to processing the selection. And also we have to say that line edit text gets deleted, so is set to having nothing inputted in it at all. Because if we don't do that, the next time we would want to change the line edit text, we would get the old name displayed that we have inputted in there, even though we don't want to use that name for that particular save file that we now want to change the name of. So that is why we have that here. Okay. And that is everything that is just for the load save menu. The other functions in here are in conjunction or working with the game event manager. So let's take a look at that one first. Now, there is a bunch of stuff in here that you don't necessarily want to deal with, that is not integral to the UI itself, like this whole stuff here, for example. Just think of it as me figuring out at this point here what kind of UI I actually want to display. And I'm setting the game event manager state according to that, so that it gets displayed, that the input is handled for that. So instead of, say, oh, move around the player, that part would be ignored if you're, for example, in the save menu, because we don't want to move around the player when we are in the save menu, obviously. So that's what set state does. And depending on where we are or what we are, what kind of UI we want to display, then we basically need to handle the other UIs accordingly so that they aren't displayed at that point. Okay. So when we are in the, when we call the UI for saving and loading, I have specialized keys for that. Later on, I will make it so that you can access them through a proper general game UI, but right now I don't have that. So I'm asking whether the buttons were pressed. And if that was the case, then we set the state accordingly for the different menus. And if they are already open, then we return to the default state, which is you can move around as a player. So when we go to set state, we have all these transition in and out stuff in here, which is just saying, okay, close basically all the other menus and open up the one menu that I actually want to have. Like in here, for example, with load menu, we are transitioning in, and all the others we are transitioning out. Player is also set to pause, as I mentioned already earlier. Now the important stuff in here for those two, for the save and load menu, is this update save slots. And you have seen this function already in here, which is this one. So, when we are calling our menu, at some point we obviously need to figure out what kind of save files we actually have and which save files should be displayed in our save slots. We don't do that just through scrolling around, but we also need to do that initially once the UI is displayed, obviously. So that's what we are doing here. We first clear our save entries in case we already have some, because we are starting from scratch at this point. We first figure out whether we are in a load menu, and if that's not the case, so meaning we are in the save menu, then we add this new save slot with a bunch of question marks to our save entries. That is basically this one entry that we have in here in order to make a completely new file without overwriting a pre-existing file. And that is what we append to save entries. Now we don't need to do that for the load menu because we don't have this sort of entry at all in there. Okay, so then we try to get all the files that we have currently on our hard drive saved. For that we call getSaveFileNames, which is another function I have made, which is this one. And what it does is it opens up the user directory and basically gets all the files that are in that directory as some sort of list. However, it skips, for one, hidden files. So on Windows, files with a dot before the name, which is this parameter here, and it skips navigational, which is this parameter here. That basically means that in directories, there is the sense of, in a directory, you can also go up a directory. And that in itself is sort of a file in some sense, according to the directory. So, or is handled as a file in a way. And we don't want to use those, obviously. We would only want to use real files, files that represent save games of our game. We don't want to deal with the navigational files in here, as they are called. So that is why we also skip those in this case. So then we can go ahead and say, okay, our current file that we want to process is the next file that dir returns to us, so our directory that we have. And if that file is actually valid, or is a valid file, basically, then we append this file to our files container, which we return via get save files. And if we append this file to our files container, then we set our new file to the next directory, to the next file in the directory, until we have all the files displayed. Then we say, okay, the directory, we end the listing and basically close that in a way, kind of similar to how file close works is this one. And then we can return our files container with the files that we have actually found in the directory. So once we've done that, here in this line, we can go ahead and iterate through all those files for this stuff. So we create a new save file, and I'm skipping mostly over this because I've explained this in the previous video. We open up the file as reading and say that we have a new save entry, and we attach to the file name of the save entry the name of the file that we actually have, but we split at the dot because we want to remove the .save extension that we have. So all we do is we insert everything before the dot into the file name of entry. Yeah. Then we get the modification time by calling the first getVar on the save file. Why we do that, I explained in the previous video. And then we also get our time string. And for the time string, this is a really long line, but it's actually rather easy to understand. We have this template string in the sense that is telling us, okay, at this point, we want a decimal, an integer basically, that has two digits. And in case it has less digits, then zero is appended before that. And we use that in order to display the proper date of the time that we are using. So we have here the day, we have here the month, and here we have the year, and for that we use four digits, because, well, a year as of now has four digits. The same is true for the hour, minute, and the second, in the sense that we have two digits and have a leading zero in case that we have less than two digits. And we input to this string via this percent sign. We input into this string the values of what gets returned by modification time. And modification time is called a dictionary. So you can look up values according to a certain name. Because it is a dictionary containing date and time, we can access the different values that are in this dictionary by calling day, month, year, or whatever else we have here in the proper sequence that we have defined in here. So that is how all those values get inserted into the string at the proper position. And then we can go ahead and say that the entry modification time string is equal to the time string that we have made here. For the thumbnail of the entry, we say we create a new image texture and create from image the new thumbnail inside the entry thumbnail and image. And for the data that we pass into create from image, we use what we have saved in the save file. Because, as you know, we have the thumbnail base is saved in our save file for our game. Okay, after that we just need to close the save file, and save entries gets this new entry appended to it. And we do that until we have iterated through all the files. And once we've done that, we do something that is, again, not necessary, but I find really good from a UI usability perspective. So in theory, if you get your save files and would display them in the sequence that you got them, you would most likely get them in an alphabetical order, because that is how they are aligned via the dictionary. But that is not what you want to have when you want to display them in a game, most likely. At least in my case, I find it really useful if the last saved game is also the one that is at the topmost position, so I can immediately access it if I want to. It also helps me when I haven't played a game for quite a while to figure out which save I actually want to use in order to continue playing the game. So that is why, instead of relying on the alphabetical default sorting of all this that we get via the get save file names, I do an additional sorting of those save entries. And in order to do that, I use this sort custom function. And it has the parameter self in order to define that you can find the function that should be used for sorting inside the script, and also the name of the function, which is sort save slots. And that is what we take a look at now. It is just this one liner down here. Sort save slots is basically called to compare every element in the container with another one. So that is what A and B are. A is one element in the container and B is another one. So by saying that they get sorted by returning the result of this condition, we are saying in which way they have to get sorted. Okay, so now let's get back to the actual update save slots. So, as I said, we are sorting our save entries, and after that we are basically doing the same thing that we did previously when we scrolled through the menu. So first we need to figure out how many iterations we actually have, whether we have the amount of slots or whether we have fewer save entries, so our iteration would also be less than number of slots. And yeah, then we iterate through all save slot indices and basically tell whether save slot is whether we set save slot to entry or whether we are not doing it. And yeah, that is basically everything for update save slots. Now, update save slots is both called in the save menu and in the load menu, because obviously we need to display them in both menus. Yeah. I think that is everything. I look around to see whether I've forgotten a function in here, but I don't see one. No, not really. I just need to that stuff I explained earlier. But maybe I should talk about this. The default thumbnail, we need to apply it in here to the entry thumbnail. And therefore, we preload the existing PNG that we used for our save slot in here in this view. We preload it in our load save menu so that we can assign it also to our entry so that it gets displayed. Because as you have seen throughout the script, we are overwriting a lot of times the default save slot look. And by doing it this way, that we reinsert the default thumbnail as an entry for the new save slot, we are avoiding a lot of checking afterwards whether what kind of thumbnail should be displayed or not. Because after that, we are using either these zero values or the entry values. And therefore it is very easy to just say, okay, the entry thumbnail for new save slot just is the default thumbnail. And therefore it will get displayed properly without us doing any extra if else statement in order to figure out whether this one should be displayed or another one. Okay. But again, I think that is most of it. I have explained all the relevant variables also. Maybe the save entry. I didn't talked about that. I needed to make an extra class for that, just so that I can have the file name modification time string and the thumbnail image in there as a variable. But that's all it is. And yeah, as I stated earlier, there is a bunch of stuff still in Game Event Manager that is also affecting the save and load menu, but not exclusively. And if you don't want to rely on the Game Event Manager, you should be able to do so with all the function that I mentioned earlier. Instead of letting Game Event Manager call the different update save slot and all that stuff, you just let your own manager or whatever script you want to use for that do the trick. And that should all work. So yeah, that's it for the UI for now. I will make an additional video talking about mainly the thumbnail, how I got that to work and what kind of tricks I had to apply there. And I hope you found this video useful, even though it was or is very long. And until next time, bye-bye.